I think that was my fault. I mean, we've seen the Coleman curse hit hard before. I'm pretty sure I've ruined multiple Raiders seasons just by giving them a vague compliment on Twitter. But damn. For the Carolina Panthers to go from allowing only 45 rushing yards per game to allowing 245 rushing yards in one game to the Cowboys, I mean, even by my lofty standards, that's gotta be a new curse record. And by the way, these are not actual real glasses, because one of the only half-decent things about my genetics is that I can actually see really well. These are blue light glasses that actually help keep me from getting migraines while I edit videos like this, but more on that later. So what exactly happened in that Cowboys game? Like, there's gotta be more to it than just Dallas good, Carolina bad, Coleman curse effective. Like, it just can't be that simple, right? The gap in talent between these two teams is not 200 yards wide. There has to be something on the coaching side of things that led to this happening. So what exactly did the Panthers change in their game plan from their first 3 weeks? Well, I actually went back and charted every single snap that this defense took against Dallas last week. And of course, I already previously charted all of the snaps they took in the other three games beforehand, so I actually think that I have a pretty good idea what really went wrong here. Based on all of my charting from every single snap taken so far this season, this is what I found. Honestly, it all comes down to personnel groupings and alignment, in my opinion. How many gigantic human beings do you have to take on their gigantic human beings at the line of scrimmage? After all, as Nick Saban once said, boxing has weight classes for a reason. Usually, the bigger dude is gonna win. And I don't know why this is, but contrary to that weight class-oriented line of thinking, for some reason, the Panthers spent a significant chunk of that disastrous game against the Cowboys in nickel personnel, or in some cases even dime personnel, so they had five or even six defensive backs on the field, despite the fact that Dallas spent much of the game in 12 or 13 personnel themselves, meaning they had two or three tight ends. That mismatch in personnel put seven or even eight big bodies in the core of the offensive formation against, in terms of weight class, a relatively light box, and the Panthers paid dearly for that decision. Carolina was convinced that they could still stop the run from nickel personnel against a dominant running team like the Cowboys, and of course they could not. Even worse though, believe it or not, is that even after it became apparent that they couldn't stop the run from nickel, they still kept trying it and they kept getting obliterated every single time until the game was basically already over. To put it into perspective, there were 12 runs from 12 personnel alone by Dallas, again meaning one back, two tight ends on the field, and most of those 12 personnel runs came from either wing or wing slot looks, or what some people like to call YY. The Panthers played against that specific personnel grouping and formation their quote-unquote normal way only one time out of those 12 runs, so they really got away from what they usually do best. If you'll remember last week's episode in which I broke down their base run defense, their favorite way to play against this kind of personnel grouping is to put a tilt nose in the weak side A-gap, they'll set a 3 technique to the strength of the formation, and they'll have a 6-eye technique on the inside shoulder of the Y tight end. This alignment is their bread and butter against wing looks from 12 personnel because it's very gap sound, and Carolina had great success with it in the past against multiple teams. But, like I said, they only used it just this one time against Dallas. And on that lone carry, by the way, which was a mid-zone call to the weak side, the front side forced a cutback to the backside C-gap, and Morgan Fox was there to close down that backside C-gap to take away that cutback lane, like he almost always is. If he didn't get held and literally dragged to the ground by the tight end, he probably could have stopped this run for no gain or maybe a yard or two at most, but even through that hold, he was still able to throw a paw out there and trip up Zeke for only 5 yards of damage. So overall, I'd still say that's a pretty effective way to play against a wing. However, the problem is, this good run fit happened with 8 minutes left in the fourth quarter. Carolina didn't use the front that they had relied on all season up to this point until Dallas was already over 200 yards rushing. It was like trying to use a band-aid to treat a bullet wound. on the other previous 11 attempts from 12 personnel that happened earlier in the game, where the Panthers played it differently for some reason, they allowed just shy of 100 total yards and almost 9 yards per carry just on those 11 touches. Even worse, when they were specifically in nickel against 12 personnel, they allowed 69 yards at almost 14 yards per carry. That is how insane the difference was when they tried to be cute and got out of their usual schematic lane against the Cowboys. They got destroyed and didn't even adjust until the game was already a blowout. I'll show you one more example just to really hammer this point home, because I truly do think it cost them this game. This is one of those misplayed wing looks from very early in the second half when Carolina still had a lead and a very good chance to win. Again, both tight ends are in the core of the formation, giving them a 7-man surface on the line of scrimmage, while the Panthers are in a 4-2 nickel overlook with two deep safeties on 1st and 10. Before this game, this was usually only a look that they reserved for 3rd and long situations against 11 personnel, but for some reason they decided to use it in this situation as well in Week 4, and you can already see the problems here with this alignment. There's only 6 defenders in the box for 7 blockers, and this C-gap bubble player, the boundary side safety, is a full 10 yards off the ball. He's way too deep for most safeties to actually fill against the run effectively. Hell, there's probably only 5 or 6 total safeties in the league off the top of my head that I think I could trust to fill from that depth, and unfortunately for the Panthers, I'm not so sure that Sean Chandler is one of them. You compare this alignment to earlier in the game, or even just earlier in the season in general, when the Jets gave Carolina a similar wing look, and the Panthers played it totally differently. They set the tilted nose to the strong side to play a gap and a half on both A-gaps, and the other defensive end, Morgan Fox, was once again playing a 6-eye technique on the inside shoulder of the tight end to be a C-gap player, just like you saw before. Do you see how much more gap sound this look is to have a 285-pound defensive lineman taking on that tight end and closing off the C-gap, rather than a 200-pound DB that is 10 yards deep? It's a totally different weight class advantage here. Going back to the Cowboys game, though, and that much worse alignment from Carolina against the wing, Dallas ran the same concept you saw earlier, mid-zone weak, but had a very, very different result. To be fair, the tilted nose did do his job and force the early cutback, which is good and somewhat normal. Shaq Thompson tried to get a run through here in the A-gap, but Zeke avoided it. Again, that's somewhat normal on a mid-zone call. But now look at where Zeke is cutting to as he works away from all of that frontside penetration. Once again, it's that backside C-gap. Zeke is hitting the exact same hole as before, except this time there's nobody there because this front was completely outgapped from the start. Brian Burns slightly hesitated to wash down because he's of course worried about losing the edge to Zeke, but because there's no other linebackers or defensive linemen to squeeze this tight end and condense that cutback lane, Zeke got these 11 yards basically for free. The only way, and I mean literally the only way to make this run fit work against this personnel grouping and formation, is for somebody in the Panthers front six to just make a batshit insane play and make up for them losing a gap. And that might only happen 20% of the time at best. The other 80% though, this kind of run is naturally what happens. And I wish that that was the only time the Panthers made this mistake and tried to handle these 12 personnel looks from nickel, but obviously it wasn't, and the pain just kept coming over and over. Do you remember that 47-yarder that Zeke broke off later in the game? The longest run since his rookie year 6 seasons ago? Yeah, that came against nickel as well, because for some reason the Panthers' plan was to put Brian Burns into position to do something that he's not really cut out to do, which is take on double teams at the point of attack and play a gap and a half in run defense. And look, I love Brian Burns, he's an amazing football player, but that's not who he is and that's not what he does. That's what Morgan Fox does, but Morgan Fox isn't on the field. And because Fox isn't on the field, now the entire structural integrity of this defense is relying on safeties to take on blocks from guys 20 to 40 pounds heavier than them, get off those blocks, and then tackle a powerful runner like Zeke full speed because their best pass rusher is getting double-teamed into Narnia. If scheming up that kind of scenario is the game plan, trust me, it's probably not a very good game plan. I just do not, for the life of me, understand why the Panthers called their game this way. Sure, you could be scared of the Cowboys passing game, and if you want to go into nickel sometimes in certain situations, I get that. But to play nickel on early downs against 12 and 13 personnel for a big chunk of this game, even after they already started gashing you on the ground, I mean, what the hell? I just don't get it. And this game plan was such a big departure from the masterful games that Phil Snow had called earlier this season that my only theory, honestly, is that they had too much time to prepare for Dallas. They had 9 full days to get ready for this game. They dug through every ounce of tape they could, including their own when they did self-scouting, and truth be told, I do think that they tried too hard to break their own tendencies and be unpredictable, which caused their defense to be completely unsound against the run. 245 rushing yards doesn't just happen by accident, and the talent differential between Dallas and Carolina certainly does not explain that kind of number either. Coaching was the culprit here, not the players. The guys on the field were not put in good spots to make plays, and I think the coaching staff is aware of that. Phil Snow and Matt Rhule are great coaches, and the Panthers are a tremendously talented defense that only got even more talented this week with the addition of Stephon Gilmore. Trust me, I am not worried about this team long term at all. But yes, we do need to acknowledge that they screwed up badly against the Cowboys, and they learned some really hard lessons. When you're going up against an offense like that, do not get cute. If you try to get cute against this version of the Dallas Cowboys, they will crush you every single time. They are way too good. Truth be told, I think we might actually get a rematch of this game in the playoffs too. I honestly believe that. And if we do get that rematch, I also believe that Carolina is going to come back with a much different game plan than the utter disaster that we witnessed last week. In terms of adjustments that I expect, I actually think that the Panthers are going to go back to what worked for them before and match size with size and physicality with physicality, because honestly, that's just their comfort zone and it's what they're good at. And in the immortal words of Nick Saban, if you can turn an offensive game plan into a question about weight classes, well, you're probably going to win that fight. Until next time, cheers. Before you go anywhere, I do want to help thank some of the people that make not just this episode possible, but every episode possible, because the folks over at Felix Gray are not just my sponsor for this week, but their blue light glasses have actually been instrumental in how I edit my shows and how I've been able to retain a somewhat passable sleep cycle for the past year and a half ever since I started using their product. I wear them during every single edit session that I do for every single episode because they actually filter out the blue light from monitors and screens and all of our general tech devices these days. And that specific part of the light spectrum, the blue light spectrum that's getting filtered out, that part of the light spectrum is what's primarily connected to eye strain and, of course, sleep cycle disruption. Felix Gray blue light glasses filter out up to 15 times more light than their competition, and they come in either prescription lenses or non-prescription like mine so that anyone can use them. I cannot possibly recommend them enough. Again, I use them in every single edit session that I do. And if you have a similar problem to me, if you get strained eyes that lead to headaches or your sleep cycle gets all messed up just from being on the computer or the phone or whatever until after midnight, like me a lot of the times, I highly recommend you try out Felix Gray blue light glasses because they actually can help you. So if you want to check these out, you can look at the entire Felix Gray catalog over on their website at the link in the description below. Again, they have every kind of style that you can ever think of, so I have no doubt that you'll find something that you like. Again, it's a great company. They've been a great partner for me for a long time, so thank you again to Felix Gray for sponsoring, and I will see you all back here next week for a very, very special, I don't want to give away what it is, but I have something very cool coming out next week. So until then, I'll see you guys later.